Well, I never really look on it as struggle, you know, because the sound thing, you see, was actually a way of life for me. I just love the music, and I never find nothing really difficult in it. I've seen people with sound system, and sometimes they get frustrated, even in instances where equipment get damaged and burn up, and you know it costs so much to replace that. They reach the verge of breakdown, they start saying that they want to sell out and come out of the business. I never see it like that at all, because I realize that, you know, electronic equipment can get damaged anytime. And you try your best and you take good care of them, but something go. And you just have to make up your mind to replace it. You might not have enough money to replace it all at once, but you do it piece by piece. And, you know, over the years, you work with a selector from the selector was kind of less unknown to the public. And then you encourage them and push them on the work hard and build up a vibe and build up a name and actually help uplift the sound as well. And then a time come where that selector may have to move on, you know, for improving himself. And sometimes it creates a little lull for the sound system. But you know, it's a part of life too, so you just have to build and rise again. Well, I kind of hate the CD thing, you know, because it takes some of the fun out of the business too. It used to be nice to watch a man take out a big 10-inch dub plate and put on a turntable and they're scratching it and mixing. And even some of the fans coming to dance used to enjoy watching that. Now, you have every little man now buy a CD burner, put it in the back room, and copy this and copy that and edit this. And you find it even destroying the record industry, because pure copies going around. Next thing with the CDs too is that because everybody believes that they are engineers and they can do their own thing. There's no consistency in the level and the quality of the sound. You hear a man play a CD and you hear about 10 different variations or even more than that throughout the night with the, both the levels and the quality. Well, I'm not going to go in any real detail, but I remember that dance still. It was a dance actually in Clarkstown, and this was supposed to be Sky Juice hometown. And Sky Juice went up there with the whole heap of bling and, you know, working pretty good too. And when Trooper time came, Trooper actually pulled a little card on him by, you know, saying that he wasn't doing nothing for the youth them in his area. And it created a big flop for Sky Juice, and I think that one really hurt him. Well, Sound Clash actually won a good place in the business, you know, because it encourages sportsmanship and it encourages people to sharpen up on their skills and stuff like that. And then, of course, you have a set of people out there who just enjoy Clash. So if you don't have Clash in the business, those people not going to enjoy themselves. Well, the biggest dub in the record box, you know. I'm not the person who decided that that was the biggest dub. The crowd out there decided that Johnny Osborne, Reason, is the biggest tune in the box. And I have to accept that because I see the response we get whenever we put it on. Well, Clash is in our blood, you know, so we couldn't... Well, I must say we are still in the Clash arena, but not to the extent where, like one time, you find that every weekend we have at least one Clash to do. And some of the Clash that people approach me with sometimes, I look at it as a waste of time. And you know, I don't get engaged in those. Because it have to work my time and effort. Because preparing for a clash is a serious thing, you know. And sometimes some little sound out there who nobody know. And it's really a waste of time to go and play with them. And them come in the dance and make up a whole heap of little noise and hype up themselves. And, you know, get boo here, right, left and center. It don't make no sense. Well, all right, it's kind of difficult to do that, but I think I can still mention some of the dancers that I consider important. One of the early clash that we had and won was with a sound. That sound, I don't think it's even playing anymore, Black Star. And then there's another sound from Waterhouse named Studio Mix. We played that sound too, that one is not around anymore. We played Jonjo Volcano sound, and that sound not around anymore. Gemini, you can name every one of those old sounds, we played them. But you see, the difference with that time and now is that in those days when you kill a sound, you know, a sound died, and that sound had to come off the road. Promoters would go back to them and take back the money. I don't know if you heard about a sound named Silverhawk. Silverhawk was doing pretty good until them decided to come and face Jaro. And that was the end of them. It's different because you have a different set of people who came in the business with a whole heap of money to spare. And these are the guys who were able to bribe some of the artists by overpaying them and say, boy, if you give me this tune, then I'll give you X amount not to give the other sound system that tune. And some of the artists get used to that big sum of money. And then they start to demand it on a non-stop basis. So it kind of discouraging for a whole lot of the younger sound. And what they end up doing is really doing some bandolo work. They might take a real song from another sound system and go on a computer and edit it and fit in another sound system in it. So you find a whole heap of fraud dub playing around the place these days.